Hey friends, Erica here from empathicwriter.com and sativayoga.com. And in this video, I'm going to talk about relational honesty. It's inspired by a note that I got from a former colleague of mine. I got it on LinkedIn, and I'm going to share with you the few lines that he sent me. He said, "Hey Erica, I hope you're doing well. I'm reaching out to you because I've been thinking about a conversation we had several years ago about empathetic people. I'm a husband and daddy to two beautiful girls, and I want to be balanced. I need to understand how to navigate being in touch with my emotions without being so emotional, sensitive to others' feelings without feeling everything." I want to share a few of the things that I've been doing for a good long time that help me as an empathic person. And before I get into those three steps, I'm going to first give a little bit of context about this empathic person. So the way the languaging has happened, I've noticed that someone who is considered highly empathic, a lot of times it just keeps on going until that it becomes a noun, and then they either call themselves an empath or other people refer to these highly sensitive, highly perceptive people as empaths. What is it? What are they? What are they doing? Empaths can feel the feelings of others, and they're real easily attuned to subtlety and nuance. So often, like reading in between the lines, hearing maybe what's not spoken or what's not so obvious, but subtle. And so there's a lot of incredible gifts that come with that, especially gifts of compassion and care and kindness, because we can, sense the emotional spectrum. So that kind of predisposes us to that capacity. And the challenge is that it can feel uncentering, ungrounding, and empaths can often feel like that they are losing themselves in the vortex of another person. And so, how do we avoid that? How do we honor this gift that we've been given while not getting burnt out and stressed out about it? Because empaths are taking in often, much more sensory data. So all five of the senses, we're collecting a bit more input and more stimulation than someone not quite as sensitive or perceptive. That's for physical senses and non-physical senses. So including the sixth sense that we've called intuition. So when you've got, everyone knows like that there's a saturation of too much information overload, and the empath is getting it, it's exponentially more. And so fatigue and overwhelm are, unfortunately, they're kind of common experiences for the empath. But another common experience is that because it feels good being around empaths often, because people often say that, being with this person, it's like they feel accepted, they feel known, seen, understood, not judged, and connected with. And so resonance and like sort of like being in flow, being in sync with another is we're attuned to harmony. That's essentially what empaths want to do. We want to harmonize situations and relationships, and make them peaceful, make them beautiful, and so that's kind of like sort of like core modus operandi of an empath. And as a result, the company with them, it usually is real pleasurable. It really feels good to be with them. And so if the empath isn't managing that and making sure that they are included on their list of of people that they're caring about, then they can get forgotten because we tend to be accommodating and it matters to us, you know, the happiness of others. And so sometimes we wrongly take responsibility for the happiness of others. So I want to share three things that I have been keeping in mind in my relationships, and they've helped me to stay grounded and centered and steady most of the time. So the first thing is to know your center and to know your ground. You've got to be able to identify things or memories or ideas or feelings that are strong enough to serve as an anchor for you so that you won't get swept up and jostled about by, you know, the energies of others. So two like fail-proof ones are usually like solitude and nature. So, okay, but what happens if you've got a really full and, you know, hectic life? Like, for instance, the person who wrote this note, he's a husband, he's a daddy, and, you know, and he's a professional. So his life really might not be giving him a lot of chances for solitude and maybe even not a lot of chances to be in nature. So what would he do? This is where I want to introduce you to something that you can have with you at all times. It's a place of mind that you can always go to, like a retreat or just, you know, peace on demand. And so if you don't have like an image or a sense of anchor that you can recall, I mean, there might be a divine persona or name or something, a prayer, a mantra, a picture, but something that can evoke a sense of solidity for you. So either you've got one or maybe you don't. And if you don't, here's a generic one you could use until you have identified your own. And that is just to envision yourself barefoot, standing on a thick slab of granite. And take the coolness of that in. And know that, like, the solidity and the stability that you feel beneath your feet, you have it just as much. You are just as anchored and just as grounded as that granite that you're standing on. So that's an image that you can, you know, invoke again until you come up with your own for how not to get wrapped up or caught up in other, you know, influences that might be louder or bigger, you know, than you, or it might feel like overtaking sometime. And that brings me to the second point, which is something that it changes things when an empath really comes to understand this, and that is that everything that you feel is not yours. So that's why it's really beneficial to know yourself and to know, like, well, what are your base emotions? What's your default state of mind? What's your home center? How do you typically feel in your deepest core? Because the better you know that, the easier it will be to reject the picking up the emotions of others. So you can, you know, if you find that you know, you're in a different kind of state of mind and it feels, you know, like maybe even like contrary to how you know yourself to feel, it's very possible that it's not yours. And in that case, it's the equivalent of carrying someone else's suitcase. Oftentimes it's like carrying someone else's garbage. Why would we do that? Don't do that. So we have to learn to sort mine, yours. And when you find something that's not yours, put it down. Even if it's, you know, someone that you love, like, but if it's the sadness or the grief, you know, of someone you love, it's still not yours to carry. That's not the best use of your life force and your energy. Put that down. So that's number two. And then number three, the big one. So I think I named this post, you know, why being honest is better than being polite. And particularly for empaths. Here's why I'm calling out those two terms in particular. Honesty. When we're honest, the etymology of that word, it means to honor. So when you risk saying what is true for you, saying true statements about who you are and what you need, you're honoring yourself. When you speak honestly, you are honoring yourself. And that's not just it. That's good, but it gets better. You're also honoring the other person that you're speaking to, because you're trusting them with a certain amount of perhaps vulnerable information, and you're giving them the chance to rise to the occasion, to respond to you in care and in love. And so when you don't do that, okay, so let's say that you choose not to be honest in your communication with others, and you're choosing to keep your connections shallow and superficial, you know, ask yourself, like, how rewarding is it to you? How fulfilling are those, like, shallow relationships? And try to imagine what would it be like to take the chance to actually show this real aspect of me, okay? And it could just be like, look, let me explain something, like, for the empath. Like, I process a whole lot of information in a day, and it means that I need naps. I have to take naps during the day in order to, you know, stay chill and stay happy. I mean, like, it could be something as like simple as that, but if you're risking something that might feel like that, you may not feel proud of it, you might even be embarrassed about it or even ashamed of it. But this is a person that you've identified as, you know, like, let's say even your partner, your beloved, okay? In the case of the person who wrote this note, your wife, you know, does she understand this about you? And if not, can you help her to learn this about you? This is important information. And presuming that she loves you, she would want this information to know how to better support you and be a partner with you. Yeah. So what I'm saying is, like, we've been trained and conditioned to do, which is this other thing, the polite thing, polite, which is, I have seen it to be cultivated dishonesty often. Okay. Polite. The etymology of polite means to polish. And guess what? You don't polish things that are living. You polish dead stuff. So while there is a place, I'm sure, in life for polished things, I challenge the notion that it would be in our relationships, polishing something. Be real, be truthful, be honest, and let's destroy the false dichotomy that thinks that the other side of truth and honesty is meanness and unkindness. Sometimes, you know, it's truth is not a machete, just like chopping people up to size. When handled rightly, truth and honesty, they are preludes to intimacy and to greater closeness and to more connection. And politeness is actually the distancer, because you're setting up, you know, you're creating barriers, but facades and masks and pretending and stuff. And so, you know, being polite, trying to be nice, but, you know, never closer. So I'm just encouraging and inviting all of us, especially empaths that, you know, need to care for yourself in different ways, perhaps. But this, I think, is true for all relationships. They all benefit from more honest encounters, and know that it is actually, you're actually making possible greater closeness. So I hope that you'll be encouraged to give it a try, to trust those that you say you love or that are close to you, to trust them with more of who you are, and to honor yourself. I hope that's been helpful.